approached this topic before. It's been discussed, mentioned in the midst of other sermons, but we're going to talk about tithing today and our giving to God. And, you know, a lot of people take great offense at that. And if they do, I don't apologize at all. It's because their attitude and their heart is not right. Okay? We are to give to God because it all belongs to God. And it just allows us a little opportunity to use the things that He has given to us. Okay? And so we're not apologetic. Actually, our tithe is an act of worship, because when we tithe with the right attitude and the right heart, we're worshiping and honoring God. Yeah, and we're demonstrating our gratitude. But if you will, let's turn over to Malachi chapter 3, verses 6 through 12. And look at our scriptures this morning. And it's a very harsh, very difficult scripture for us to read, and kind of has a curse and a blessing mixed in with the same scriptures. And so let us look at those this morning. It says, "For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore you, O sons of Jacob, are not consumed from the days of your fathers. You have turned aside from my statutes and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you say, how shall we return? Will a man rob God?" Will you rob God? "Yet you are robbing me. But you say, how have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, so that there may be food in my house, and test me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you a blessing until it overflows. Then I will rebuke the devourer for you, so that it will not destroy the fruits of the ground, nor will your vine in the field cast its grapes, says the Lord of hosts. All the nations will call you blessed, for you shall be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts." Let us pray. Our most gracious God in heaven, Father, I just want to thank you today for the opportunity to be with my brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to thank you today for the blessings that you have poured out on us. God, I praise you today for the miracle of your rain that you have sent to our dry and parched land and to our crops that were about to burn up and dry up. And Father God, we give you the glory and the honor today for whatever they become and whatever fruit that they yield and produce. We acknowledge that you are in control of all things, dear God. And we place our faith and our trust in you for that. Father, as we look at our opportunity, our responsibility, and our privilege to bring our offerings and our tithes to you, dear Lord, open our hearts as to what our attitude is toward you, and help us to see where we are and if we need to make corrections and changes in that, Father. God, I love you, and I praise you today for all that you do. I ask all this in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now, the reason that I have come before you this morning to even present this scripture is we had business meeting last week, and our expenses at our church are running pretty steady. There's no major catastrophes going on. Now, there's always a little bit of something, but, you know, minor repair here and a minor repair there. Our expenses have stayed real steady, but our tithes have dropped off dramatically, by the tune of $2,000 to $3,000 a month. And so we've run in the red for the last couple of months, run a deficit. And you know, we've got a reserve built up because God has blessed us. And so but we don't have enough to last very long. If something doesn't change, if we don't change, either in our giving or our spending, About 2 years, we can go lock that door and turn the key over to somebody else and say, see you later. Okay? So that's kind of where we're at as far as this church goes. And I thought it was prudent that we understand and know what it really means to tithe. There are so many people that really do not have a grasp and a concept of what tithing is. And so we can only understand tithing and all our offerings when we look back at the history. How did this all get started? How did this come about? And if our first set of scriptures is going to be in Genesis 14, 17 through 20, and I'll read those here in just a moment. The first reference to offering a sacrifice or making an offering to God is actually in Genesis chapter 4, when Cain and Abel bring their offering before God. That is the first instance. We have instances where Job also brought sacrifices to God, and he would sacrifice on behalf of his children and offer prayers for his children. And we have those instances. The instance of tithing in Genesis chapter 14, and let me turn over there, and I hope I haven't lost my little marker somewhere here. There it is. Chapter 14, verses 17 through 20. And says, then after his return, talking about Abram, this is before God changes Abram's name to Abraham. Then after his return from the defeat of Chedorlaomer and the kings who were with him, the king of Sodom went out to meet him at the valley of Shaveh, that is the king's valley. And Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. Now he was a priest of God Most High. He blessed him and said, blessed be Abram of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand. He gave him a tenth of all. He, meaning Abram, gave unto Melchizedek a tenth of all that he had. And that's the definition of the word tithe, is a tenth. It's the tenth part. It's 10%, any way you want to look at it. There are a lot of folks that want to say, oh, Christians aren't supposed to tithe because tithing is Old Testament law. Well, the tithe began before Old Testament law began. Okay? So it is not tied to Old Testament law, to Mosaic law. It is reaffirmed and defined a little further when we get into Old Testament. But see, as we look at this scripture, we've got a lot to see. Abram, in this instance, gave a tenth of his income, a tenth of his increase. He had gone to war, a band of raiders had came in and taken some of his family, Lot and his family, had taken them captive and plundered their land. And so Abram puts together him a small army and through the power of God, defeated five kings, and he took plunder and he took spoil and all from those kings and brought it back with him. And he gave a tenth of all his increase. So if you're a businessman, you tithe off your profit. Okay, that's the lesson to be learned there. He gave a tenth of that to this priest, Melchizedek. Well, who's this guy? Well, Melchizedek, there's a lot of stuff we need to see here. It's going to get dull, it's going to get a little boring, but I want you to pay attention. Melchizedek is a precursor, if you will, an image of Christ. He is number one, a priest of the Most High God. And Jesus Christ is our priest that sits at the right hand of God today, is he not?
Amen.
All right, so, and he intercedes for us. And so that was what Melchizedek's position was. It was also, his name, Melchizedek, translates into King of Righteousness. What is Jesus Christ? Is one of his titles not Righteous King and the King of Righteousness? And he is also the King of Salem. And the word Salem is peace, translates peace. And so he is also the King of Peace. What is there one of our titles for Jesus. Is he not the King of Peace?
Amen.
Melchizedek has no genealogy, no history. He has no, therefore, no beginning. He has no death, no other information about him. So he has no ending, no end. And our Savior, Jesus Christ, has no beginning because he was in the beginning with God. And he has no ending because he sits for eternity at the right hand of God. So he is an image, a picture to us of Christ. This place, Salem, is actually the city that becomes Jerusalem. Okay? Where God comes and sits at the temple when King David builds it, or Solomon builds it, okay? That's another tie in there that we need to see. What does he bring? He brings bread and wine. Are those not the items that we use as we remember our Lord's death on the cross when we have Holy Communion? Amen. When we observe the Lord's Supper, we have bread and we have wine, signifying the flesh and the blood that is shed and sacrificed for us. So Melchizedek is a real important individual. In the New Testament, Jesus is referred to as a priest on the order of Melchizedek because of all of these things that I have told you about. And so Abraham gives 10% of what God blesses him with, of his increase. 10%. Well, there are proponents that say, well, that's just was kind of the standard of the day. No, it's not. It was mentioned, it's brought to us, and we're told about it because it was so much above what was normal and customary in this day and time. It was the generosity, and it demonstrates the piety and the righteousness of Abram. Jacob also, before the Mosaic law, also gives the 10%. And if we think, oh, the tithing is just Old Testament stuff and we're not bound by Old Testament anymore because we're free from the law and we don't have to obey that, look over in Hebrews chapter 7, where Brother Paul, as he writes, in my opinion, as he writes the book of Hebrews, he refers back to this exact same situation, using it as an illustration of why we are to continue in our giving. So there's a great history to tithing. It's not something that we just came up with to make preachers rich, okay? It was something that God inspired and God endowed in us a long time ago. And so we need to see that history and understand where it all began to understand and know why it is that we give a tithe, okay? So that's kind of our history. So what is the purpose of the tithe? And we're going to look at our Mosaic law there. And as I kind of looked and saw and tried to understand here, there's two primary purposes for tithing. The first purpose is to maintain and support the house and work of God. In verse 10, it tells us, so that there may be food in my house. We must understand, in Hebrew times, we would bring our tithe into our local synagogue. Whatever God had blessed us with, whether it be cattle, whether it be grapes, whether it was figs, whatever God had blessed us with and had enriched us with, we were to bring in our tithe to our local synagogue. Those items were used to maintain the ministers, the ministries, and the house of worship that was there in that local spot. And we do the same thing today. That was the Levites, the local priests, they had no inheritance of their own. And so their sustenance depended upon the heartfelt gratitude of the people of God, bringing their tithes into the storehouse, bringing in the produce that had been come. This was an agricultural society. That was their primary means of barter, was it not? You know, we'd swap, you know, a cow and two chickens for, you know, a donkey and two sheep and a, I don't know, a gopher or something, you know, or maybe a bushel of wheat. And it was, that was their currency. That was their exchange. And so they would bring those items into the synagogue, and they were commanded in the Mosaic law to bring the first, to bring the best, because what does God deserve? He deserves the best. So we are to bring in whatever God has blessed us with to maintain this building. How many of you really enjoy when you come to church on Sunday morning, you have a soft, comfortable pew to sit on? You've got nice bright lights so you can see where you're going. We've got hot and cold running water in the bathroom so you can go potty here in a minute. We've got air conditioner or heater for whatever time of year it is, so we can sit here and enjoy all of that. Well, all those things cost money, do it not? I mean, it takes resources to keep those things together. This practical application of God's law, of God's command to us. We need the tithe to maintain our building. We also use tithes to maintain our ministers. You know, there are several here that do work here at the church that receive compensation for those labors, do they not? You know, Brother J.L. gets paid to mow the grass back here and to keep this place back here from becoming a weed pile, and you spray the weeds and all of that kind of stuff, do you not? You know, we've got Brother Billy that, you know, we all like a nice clean carpet, and we sure like to have a nice clean commode when we go to the bathroom. We like to be sure there's paper towels in the paper towel dispenser. And Brother Billy takes care of those things. Colleen and Becky, they play our piano. We compensate all those folks. You compensate me richly and abundantly for my coming here and standing before you each and every Sunday. All of those things have been decided on by a vote of our church. The amount, the people, everything, all of that has been voted on by you. It was your decision to make that expenditure. Okay? So that's a practical aspect. We also use our tithes and offering. See, our church, we support the ministries of God, because 10% of all of our resources, all of our revenues, automatically go into our missions fund. See, in the Old Testament, when the tithes were brought to the synagogue, to the local synagogue, then that priest there would tithe his tenth of that to the temple, to the tribe of Aaron, to the descendants of Aaron, to the priest at the temple in Jerusalem. And so we tithe our tithe, just as in the Old Testament they tithe their tithe to maintain the temple in Jerusalem, to keep that group of priests fed and sustained, and to support the ministries and the work. We do the same thing here. We support our ministers. We support the work of God. We do the 10% goes directly into our missions fund. We tithe our tithe. And those mission funds, we actually support four different mission groups. We have three missionaries that are in field that we monthly send contributions to help in their efforts to share the gospel. And plus we also give to the SBTC and to support that work there. So we're doing that. We also use portions of that to purchase Sunday school literature, to provide activities for our young people, to buy food for our fellowships, to support the work locally, do we not? Yeah. This is a practical aspect. So we support the house of God, we support the ministers of God, and we support the ministries of God through our tithe. That's a practical aspect of all of this. And we all appreciate that. We all want those things, do we not? Amen. But they all cost money. They all got to be paid for. But you know, there is a far, far more important purpose to tithing. Because it reflects our heart and our attitude toward God. Amen. Because when we tithe, we are saying unto God, and we tithe with the right heart and the right attitude, we're saying unto God, God, you have blessed me with so much. how can I ever repay you? Let me just give you a portion as an indication of our love. See, a tithe is 10%. An offering, that's our baseline, y'all. That's the baseline. An offering is the things that we give above and beyond that. And there's a spiritual purpose to our tithing. It demonstrates our faith in God, that God has provided us with so much that I can faithfully return to God a portion and know that He is still going to provide for me. You remember the story of the three servants that the master gave one 5 talents, one 3 talents, and one talent. What did they start with? They started with nothing. They had absolutely nothing. Everything they had came from God. The master gave them all they had to begin with. You and I don't have anything, do we? We don't own anything. We are a servant of God. God owns everything. You think you own your house. You think you own your car. You think you own your children. You do not. It all belongs to God. He gives it to us to be a servant of and to be a steward of. And they took those items and they, used them and produced with them and increased what God had given to them. But then what did they do with it? They didn't bring back to God a tenth of it, did they? They brought back to God all of it, what He had given them to begin with and what they had increased from it. Except for the one guy that just took it and hit it, right? And God took that away from him. Because that's what our attitude should be towards God. I don't own anything. See, that's one of those we get in a fight with God. Well, that's my house. I've worked hard to pay for that house. That's my pickup. I've worked hard to pay for that pickup. Those are my kids. I'll tell them what to do and where to go and where to live, how to live their life. No, they belong to God. We don't own anything. And when we are faithful in our tithe, which guess what? Our tithe is not just our money. Amen. We just sang the song, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, all your money, all your talents, all your time, and most of all, your love.
Amen.
Because is that not what God commands us to do? Is to love one another? See, tithing reflects our heart. Matthew 6 and 24. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. So if we say we love God and we're following God, we're obedient to God, but God, this is mine. The money is mine, and I let you have what I want you to have. That's the wrong heart. That's the wrong attitude to have. It all belongs to Him. And we need to be grateful. See, there's a practical aspect to that spiritual purpose. If you will offer to God, here's my resources that you have blessed me with, and you begin to make a budget for your household, and you bring to God the first fruits. You get your paycheck, and it's $500. $50 is going to God. Yeah. Okay? That's the tithe. That's the first fruit. That's the best. That's that heart of gratitude. Yeah. Okay? Whatever your paycheck is, you just move 1-0, and that's how much your tithe should be. Now, you're free to give your offering above that. There's nothing that says that's all you can give. In fact, when we look at New Testament giving, we look in Acts, I believe it's chapter 4, at the first church, what was everybody doing? Everybody owned everything. It was all considered community property. And those who had houses and lands were selling their houses and land and bringing their money and laying it at the disciples' feet to use for those who were in need. Gave everything. That's the New Testament example that we are to follow. So if you don't like the Old Testament one, you really don't like the New Testament one, right? Okay. Let me think of where I was headed with this. When we give, we need to give with a generous heart. We need to give from the first of our fruits. Just as with Cain and Abel, let's look back at them a minute. Abel, when we look in Genesis chapter 4, verses 3 and 4, we look and we see, it just says, Cain brought an offering to God. And it says, Abel brought from the first of his livestock, and he brought the fat offering. In other words, he brought the best. He brought the most precious that he had and offered it to God. And it's an indicator of our heart, is it not? That we love God and we're grateful for what God has given us. And look what he's blessed us with. Let me give a portion of it back. Cain brought the leftovers. Well, I paid my house bill, my house rent, and I paid my electric bill, and I paid my pickup payment, and I paid for the rent to own on my sofa, and I've paid my TV cable bill, and I've paid all of this, and I got $100 left, so yeah, I'll throw $10 in the offering plate. That ain't the way God looks at it. Don't give God your leftovers. Give God the first fruits. Where did it all originate in the first place?
Amen.
It originated with God. Amen. Whatever you have, whatever your circumstance, and it's not about how much. Remember the widow with the two mites? But that was all that she had. All the others was giving a whole lot more. Oh, they were just filling the coffers up with their monies. But they were giving out of their surplus. But she gave all that she had. That's another one of those New Testament examples of how much we're to give to God. Because it's a demonstration of faith when we tithe. And it's a demonstration of love and gratitude and thankfulness to God for all that he has blessed us with. 2 Corinthians 9, 6 and 7. Now this I say to you, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will reap bountifully. Each one must do just as he has purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. See, we don't give because we got to. We don't give because God's going to zap us. We don't give to get more, do we? We give because we want to give. We give from a heart of gratitude. We give because God has blessed us so richly. And there's no way we can outgive him.
Amen.
See, God doesn't worry so much about how much you. He worries about why you give, what your heart is towards giving. Well, the old theologians put it in this way. George Mueller. God judges what we give by what we keep. He judges what we give by what we keep. Or we may put $100 in the offering plate this Sunday. But if we still got $10,000 that he's blessed us with this week, if we give him very much. Way too many of our church attenders today show up, and when they get here, as an afterthought, they pull out their billfold. Well, I've got a 10 and I've got a 50. Yeah, that 10 will work. Instead of sitting down Saturday, Friday night, saying, you know, here's what God blessed me with this week. Let me write a check for this amount and put that in the plate on Sunday. They've prepared and they're ready for it. And they give it because they wanted to. Amen. Looking at it from a slightly different perspective here, God doesn't need your tithe.
Amen.
Does he? It's all his already. He's just allowing you to be a steward of it. We are the ones that need to tithe. We need that blessing. We need that heart change. We need that attitude of understanding. It ain't mine to begin with.
Amen.
What a great God we have to let us have this good stuff. I'm giving a portion back to him so that someone else can be just as blessed. And see, in verse 10 there it says to bring the whole tithe. Don't bring the leftovers. Don't bring a portion. Don't bring what you got left at the end of paying everything else. Bring the whole tithe. If not, you're robbing from God. You know, we studied in our Sunday night last week about Phineas and, or 2 weeks ago, I guess it was. Now, Phineas and what's the brother? I can't remember his name all of a sudden. Anyway, we studied about them and how they were cheating God and they were robbing God. And Eli said, if you wrong a man, God can mediate that. But when you wrong God, there is no one to mediate between you and God. Man, you're in trouble when you've wronged God. I can maybe fix a problem between me and Kelsey. Between me and God, I can't fix that. God's the only one who can fix that. So, are you holding back from God? If you put your faith in your ability to make money, and you just kind of give God what you want to give to him, we need to put our faith in him, that he's going to provide for us. See, when you start making that budget, you start giving on a regular basis, and you're conscious of what you're using your money for, you begin to realize how foolishly you waste a lot of money. And you become a better steward of what you keep for yourself when you start to budget and you put God first, that he's getting his right off the top. And then I've got these other things that have to go with it. You become more conscious and you don't have to have that double dip ice cream cone down at Cold Stone Creamery. Okay? You don't have to have that double mocha latte from Starbucks every day. You don't have to have that brand new pair of shoes every week. You don't have to have that brand new rifle to go hunting with. We don't have to have all those things. See, when we get our heart right with God, so this is the promise. You looked at the promise that if we are obedient to give to God, if we are obedient to do as God has called us to do, if we are giving to God from the gratitude of our heart, what does he promise us there? He says to test him in this. This is one of the very few times that God says to test him.
Amen.
I will open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you a blessing until it overflows. But we got to bring the whole tithe. We must be obedient to God.